Hello and greetings everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Doug Bito. I am the Clinical Marketing Manager with TomTech Imaging. Today's webinar, we will focus on a very important topic, diabetic heart disease. And joining me today is Bernhard Mumm, President of TomTech Imaging. As always, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Mumm as our guest speaker here with TomTech Academy. And of course, thank you everyone for joining us. Bernhard?
Yes, Doug, thank you very much for your introduction. Hello everybody, welcome to our TomTech Academy session on a very important topic, diabetic heart disease, and especially on how can we use echocardiographic methods in order to detect an early diabetic myocardial disease. And that this is a very important topic shows the list of participants. We have a nice group from all around the world, around the globe, from Australia. And I have to say it's very late midnight in Australia, so thanks for joining us from Europe, of course, and a lot of participants from the United States. So if we look to diabetes and the problem of diabetes, we have luckily worldwide an aging population, so we are all getting older, which is very nice, but it comes with problems if we are getting older. And on top of that, worldwide we have an increase of physical inactivity, which leads as well with the lifestyle changes to an increase of obesity. And if you look to this cartoon I found, this shows the problem that the obesity already starts with children, and that childhood obesity is becoming increasing all the time. So this all together, all these facts together bring us this increase of diabetes. And let me just focus on the problem of obesity for a moment. If we look to the statistics in the United States, so more than 70% of the entire population in the United States is overweighted or obese, means heavy overweighted, and this is dramatically changing. So, and these figures are from 2010, and meanwhile in 2016 they're already higher. But it's not only a problem in the United States. If we look to the effects in Germany, as well as figures from 2010, around one quarter of the population in Germany of the men is obese. But as well in other areas of the world, like the Middle East, there's a prognosis that more than 35% of the population there will be obese in 2030. So a worldwide problem, as said before, and this brings a huge cost of for the healthcare system, the obesity. Again, the figures from 2010, around $150 billion United US dollars. And this will increase within the next years, 2030, to $300 billion. And with that, we will see a doubled new cases of diabetes, hypertension, and heart disease, so diabetic heart disease. Out of these two problems, obesity and diabetes, there is this new term created, diabesity, which exactly describes this unhealthy relationship between these two here. And I found this other cartoon showing that obesity could become the much bigger global threat compared to global warming or something like that, as this will be a huge threat to our social systems and the healthcare systems. Now let's come to the topic of today, diabetic heart disease, and what does it mean for people and the patients. So people having diabetes, they are much higher risk for heart disease, which they develop at a younger age, and if they become heart disease, it's a much more severe way of heart disease. And this type of heart disease includes coronary artery disease, heart failure, cardiomyopathy, hypertrophy of the left ventricle, and so on. And this group of patients, they have a much higher, 2 to 4 times higher likelihood to have heart disease or a stroke. The problem here is, but these patients, diabetic patients, they show very late symptoms. So they have a long preserved ejection fraction, an example. They show late symptoms of myocardial ischemia or reduced systolic function. And with this delayed diagnosis, we have a worsened prognosis for survival for this group of patients. So therefore, diabetes can be called the silent killer, as these changes, the subclinical changes, are getting there very early and can be diagnosed too late. And that's why an early detection of diabetic heart disease is, in our opinion, very important. And I would like to show you within the next minutes how we believe this can be done with new techniques in echocardiography. This graph, I think, shows it very nicely, the relationship between ejection fraction and strain and myocardial deformation. And if you look to this blue line here, during the progress of LV dysfunction and where the patient could already show preclinical symptoms of dysfunction, we have a preserved ejection fraction. And this preserved ejection fraction and the reduced global lung strain is compensated by an increase in the circumferential deformation of the ventricle. So this circumferential strain or deformation is getting higher in the beginning of a progressive dysfunction of the left ventricle and is compensating for ejection fraction. And that's why we believe global lung strain is a very early depictor here. You see it starts early to be reduced, being a very nice measurement for measuring preclinical symptoms of LV dysfunction. So early detection, again, very important. With this new technique, myocardial strain assessment, and especially as shown nicely here in this graph with the global longitudinal strain. If we look to this a little older American Heart Association statement about diabetes and cardiovascular disease, they said, and it's still valid, that an early detection of subclinical atherosclerosis and cardiovascular disease could reduce the morbidity and mortality for these diabetic patients and could lead and help for to plan a more effective prevention or treatment for these patients. So as this talk is about echo and echocardiography, which tools do we have with echo? And of course we have all the standard 2D and 3D echo measurements, measuring the volumes and the geometry of the left ventricle, thickening and so on. However, as the graphs before have shown, ejection fraction is not sensitive enough for this subclinical depiction of early diabetic heart disease. That's why we believe we need better tools. Of course, stress echo helps us to look at probably abnormalities and coronary artery disease. And I found this publication about the prognostic value of stress echo or exercise echo in diabetic patients, saying that stress echo is a very useful method to predict cardiac events in diabetic patients with suspected coronary artery disease. Then another tool definitely is to look at the carotids and to measure interior medial thickness, or look at plaques in the carotid as subclinical markers for atherosclerosis, and this should be done. However, as shown before, we believe that this new technique of strain is very powerful, especially the global lung strain, in order to look at the global but as well the regional function of the left ventricle and myocardial mechanics. Let me focus for the next slides on strain, and especially this important GLS. GLS stands for global longitudinal strain measurement, and to show you how simple it is on these two phantoms. So on the left side we have this green line showing us the length of the ventricle of the subendocardium here, and diastolically, and then the same and systolically in this phantom. And then we put that into a simple formula. So we calculate the delta of the long line versus minus the shorter line, divided by the long and diastolic lengths here. This gives us the strain in percentage. So if we take this measurement, 135 minus 180 divided by 180, we have minus 25% global lung strain, which is very good. Of course, we would not do that by hand, and that's why we developed completely automatic tools like this TomTec AutoStrain package, which is completely automatically depicting the left ventricular heart chamber, and then the subendocardium, and is then tracking the subendocardium throughout the cardiac cycle. It is completely automatically finding the end diastolic and systolic phase, and is giving us then not only the global lungular strain, but then as well volumes and ejection fraction. We will come to that a little later, but before, let me just explain you how this technique of speckle tracking works. And this I would like to show you with this small video clip here, and I hope it plays fast enough on your screen. You see here this pattern, and this pattern is trying with speckle tracking, with tracking techniques, in order to follow the motion of this this person's head throughout this classroom. And you see the people moving around these newspapers, and the newspapers are symbolizing noise in front of this pattern, this head. And you see that the tracker, even with the noise, is able to track the head of this patient. And that's more or less what we do with speckle tracking in the heart. And we pick out small areas here, like this region of interest. And within this area, then we look for a special speckle pattern, typical gray value patterns from the myocardium. And then we can track that from one phase to the other during the cardiac cycle, and see where this sample region of interest is moving from one pattern, one phase to the next one, or an example where this part of the septum is moving. And we would do that not only for the septum, but for all pieces of the ventricular wall. And this is now illustrated by this yellow arrows you see here, moving in and out, showing us the direction of the wall motion, and the length of the vector is giving us the speed of the wall motion. So we get all this visual assessment of the ventricular wall motion, but as well a quantitative assessment. We can measure that. So, but what is the problem with strain in the past? And that's why in the past strain was supposed not to be so independent from different vendors and from the different techniques. And I would like to illustrate that with this simple phantom again. And you see three lines here. So the inner line is the so-called endostrain, and as I've shown you before, this endocardial strain, minus 24% in this example, on the same heart, if we would measure just mid-myocardial, the strain is reduced to 18, not because the ventricle is worsened, but because of the changed geometry of my measurement line. And if I would do on the same ventricle the measurement at the epicardium, we would have a strain, an epicardial strain of minus 13, which is nearly half of the endocardial strain. Again, it's the same heart, the same phantom in this example, but just measured at a different position. And this shows how important it is to come up with a definition. How should strain, in this example, global longitudinal strain, be measured? That's why a so-called strain task force has been implemented a couple of years ago, with the goal to standardize deformation imaging or strain imaging. And this was a combination of academia and industry, so the American Society of Echo and the European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging, together with all the ultrasound industry, came together in this task force. And the goal was to agree how to measure, where to measure, how to call the measurements, which formulas should be used, and to validate it. And the first paper, definition paper, came out end of 2014 already. And this paper nicely describes how strain should be measured and what should be the nomenclature for measuring strain. And if we look to the interest from the clinicians here, this paper was one of the most popular articles published in 2015 by the statistics of the journal. This came from the European journal, but I think it's the same for Chase. This shows how important the outcome of the strain task force is in order to come up with better definitions. So the second step of the strain task force was to look at phantoms and to see if all the ultrasound vendors, so all the ultrasound companies having strain on board and companies like TomTec joined together and got the same vendors from the Leuven group, engineering academic group, and they developed a special strain phantom here. And you see this phantom here was a given strain. However, this was given to all the companies in a blinded way, so none of the companies have been aware of what is the real strain within this speckle pattern in this phantom. And we all had to measure then with our tools the strain in a blinded way against the others and against the ground truth. And this was done for all different kinds of heartbeats, like 70 beats per minute or up to 150 to mimic the stress echo examination. And the results of this work have been published as well in 2015 here. And the conclusion was very surprising for everybody that the accuracy of the current available products have been acceptable just on the fact that we all agreed to measure subendocardia, and not one company measures mid-myocardial and the other company transmural. So we all measured subendocardial, and with this simple definition, the relative errors could be below 10% and the intravenular reproducibility within 5%, which is, in our opinion, very good already. And then we tried as a task force to move on and do the same validation, not on phantoms, but on real clinical data. And within 1 week, all the ultrasound companies, seven companies, and like us, TomTec, we came together in Leuven and scanned all the same patients with all the seven scanners. And then the strain analysis was done on all systems. This was published end of 2015, called the head-to-head comparison of global longest strain among nine vendors. And again, we had a very consistent message. If we compare that with our phantom tests, that the reproducibility of global longitudinal strain was good, in many cases superior to all other conventional echo measurements. And this was very interesting, that if we say, yeah, all the echo measurements, the 2D measurements, and the action fraction is very robust and very good, but we could show that the intervendor variability for all these conventional measurements was much, much, much higher than what we have done with strain, with global longitudinal strain. And that with these findings, we believe that GLS may be safely used in clinical routine. This was then implemented as well in the latest ASE and European Association guidelines and the recommendation paper for cardiac chamber quantification, which came out last year. And if we look to this paper, what it says about strain, it says that global longitudinal strain measurements should be made in three standard apical views and averaged. And it says what is the normal range of global longitudinal strain, -18 to -20%. And better is, of course, always better. And that's what we then implemented in our TomTec autostrain package. You see here, we take the four-chamber view, the two-chamber view, and the three-chamber view. And as I could show you before, the software is now doing all the analysis completely in an automatic way. And you see now the tracking of the subendocardium in these three views. And then what you see in the upper left corner here, the software is giving you then all the values, not only the strain values, but as well the volumes, stroke volume, and ejection fraction. And then it gives you not only the strain for the three-chamber, two-chamber, or four-chamber, but as well then an average strain, the so-called three-plane strain, -21%, which is very healthy here in this aspect. So another publication here in Czech, September last year, which compared our fully automatic strain measurement, and it compared it with visual assessment and manual measurement of strain in the action fraction. And this was done in four centers worldwide on 255 patients. Here in this publication or this work, it was only on the 204 chamber view. So again, visual against manual tracing against automatic method. And the conclusion here was that the fully automatic measurement of ejection fraction and strain, the global glomerular strain, had basically no variability because the algorithm is doing always the same independently if this algorithm is used by a doctor in the United States, here in Munich, or somewhere in India or in Australia. It will give you exactly the same value, and it's very rapid and very reproducible with that. And these algorithms we developed are based on machine learning, so-called cognitive computing, which really is doing then all this work for you, and then with that we have this no variability advantage. If we look to this specific paper about a strain assessment on diabetic patients here, and again looking for the longitudinal myocardial strain on this diabetic patients, it says that this is a very useful method in order to look at the subclinical systolic abnormalities and to really identify patients with diabetes at an earlier stage, and then start then treatment in the right way. Up to now, what I've showed you was based on 2D echo, but of course 3D echo can do even a better job here, because then we can not only assess two-chamber, three-chamber, four-chamber view, but the entire ventricle, and can do the measurement in 3D based on 3D echo. And let me show you the simple workflow here. So the 3D echo data set is loaded to the software. Again, then nearly fully automatic tracking techniques gives you this, what we call it, the Beutel, the cast of the left ventricle in a static and then dynamic way. You could check it and adapt it if you are not happy with the results, but the goal is really it should be as automated as possible, and then you get all the parameters based on 3D echo, like volume, ejection fraction, 3D strain, and even the twist and the torsion of the ventricle in this three-dimensional automated way. Let me show you this example here. This is a reduced left ventricle function, and you see these different graphs here. If you look to the parameters, you see the global glomerular strain GLS of -8.4, which is very reduced, and it fits with the reduced ejection fraction 30% here. And if you look now to this color-coded bullseye view in the upper right side, you see this yellow segment at the septal between anterior septal segments of the ventricle, and this means this is a reduced deformation. In this case, we displayed a displacement kind of strain here, and then you can even have an original assessment which sectors, which areas of your ventricle are reduced in terms of ventricular function. This is a paper I found about the use of three-dimensional echo and the strain based on three-dimensional echo in diabetic mellitus patients. And the conclusion here is that 3D echo based GLS may be a sensitive indicator, again, for early LV systolic dysfunction assessment in this group of diabetic patients, even despite they have a normal ejection fraction. And remember the graph I showed me before, long-term preserved ejection fraction, but you already have a dramatic decrease in global glomerular strain at an earlier stage. Let me come to my conclusion, and I hope I could show you that echocardiography is an excellent tool in order to detect early diabetic myocardial disease, and that this new two-dimensional and three-dimensional echo techniques, especially strain, allow you a much better qualitative and, very important, quantitative evaluation of cardiac function. And what I showed you here, with our tools, the auto strain, we can do that very nicely and completely automated based on 2D echo in these three planes, but you can do it as well on one of these three planes if you only have one, a four chamber or a two chamber available. And then if you have a 3D echo data set, of course, then we recommend to use a three-dimensional assessment called 4D LV analysis in order to do the same assessment in a three-dimensional way. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention. And like always, now we have a question window, so you can type in your questions, and then we hope we can answer your questions. And feel free, if you have questions later on, to just send us an email with your question, and then we will repeat by email and hope to answer your questions then later on. Again, thank you very much, and let's go to the questions here. So my problem that the question is so small on my monitor. Let me just read it here. So the question was, I noticed that in the apical street chamber view, the automatic contour went all the way into the aortic root. As far as I'm aware, this goes against a manual contour advice given by Tomtic before, or am I completely wrong? So Doug, you are still with us. And at, meanwhile, I tried to go back to the contour you describe in my presentation here to see it. Let me just see where we are here. So I think you referred to the lower left side here. So I think it, what we do here should be correct, so that the contour goes here till yeah, the aortic root, not directly completely to the root. And I would say this is right. Of course, it's a question what is completely right here. But if I look to this example, what you referred to, I would say the tracking has done a good job here. And again, I think it's more important to track changes. So if you have the algorithm always doing the same thing, it will track in the same way the next time. And if the patient comes back, it will do the same assumption again 1 week, 1 month, 1 year later. And then it gives you a much more precise change in ventricular function. And that's the important point, because every patient is a little different. But to be able to track the changes of a patient throughout the disease progress. Now we have another question here. Have you found that there is a better format of receiving the images, DICOM or AVI, to get better assessment? So what we definitely propose is to use DICOM and not AVI. And I think our tools even cannot read AVI files, so that's why it's necessary to have DICOM clips. And this is anyway the worldwide standard. Of course, if you have nothing else than AVI, you need to do that. But go with DICOM. So the next question here is, are the readers marking the contours for tracking or Tomtic system? So definitely what you are seeing playing on the screen here is the system is completely depicting the left ventricular heart chamber in the four chamber, in the two chamber, in the three chamber view, and is completely automatically finding the borders here of the endocardium. And the user could overrule it later on after the system has given you these results. You can go in, stop it, and pick the contour you use your mouse and adjust it if you're not happy with that. So coming to the first question, you could do manually going down a little bit with your end of the contour as the at the aortic root if you believe it needs to be a little lower, or in this case a little upper towards the apex. But our goal is really that the algorithm should do it completely automatic. So then another question here is, how often should a diabetic mellitus patient have these tests performed? That's a little difficult for me to give you this answer, as I'm not a practical clinician. But I would say once a year this should be checked, and if you see a faster development of the subclinical problems of LV dysfunction, then probably it should be done earlier. But compared to cardio-oncology, where you need to do it much, much more often, I think 1 year should be enough. But be a little bit careful with what I tell you here. Then we have another question. Are there, just a moment. So now, sorry, my question window disappeared here. Just a second. So somehow now my question window disappeared. Doug, are you still with us? Do you see the question window?
I do, Bernard, and I can read the question to you. The next question is, are there settings on the ultrasound needed to make sure the tracking occurs correctly, frame rates or gain settings?
I think the frame rate, or if you go to the 3D echo, the volume rate should be high enough. So if you have, an example, in 3D echo, a volume rate, and I've seen one acquisition today where the volume rate was 10 volumes per second, and then we believe this is not enough in order to make a very good measurement here. Typically, if you have a normal ultrasound system and you're in 2D, you have whatever, more than 30 frames per second, and this should be enough. Of course, 40, 50, 60 frames per second is okay, but in our experience, we believe 30 frames per second is already enough. And there was a very nice publication talking about the influence of frame rate on measuring strain on 2D echo. And if you're interested, I can send it to you. If you would send me an email with your email, I could send you this publication to look more into the details here. Doug, do we have another question? So it seems there is no other question, Doug. So if there is no other question, then thank you very much again. If you have more questions a little later on, send your questions by email. And like always, you can download the recorded webinar then a little later from our webpage. I think it should be there by tomorrow. And then you can review it and listen to it again. And have a nice day, evening, night. And thank you again. And we hope you will join one of our upcoming Tom Dick Academy webinars in the future. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.